H.E. Bates is perhaps best known for his fictional depictions of rural English life in novels such as 1958's The Darling Buds of May. The bucolic setting of such works reflected a deeper personal affinity for the English countryside. Nowhere is this made more evident than in two collections of essays by Bates, Through the Woods and Down the River. Here I'll be taking a look at the former of these two books, which I have in its 1936 second impression of the first edition, published by Victor Gallants. The book is bound in russet cloth, with the title blocked simply in gilt atop the spine. It comes with a dust jacket that is printed in brown with a cover design featuring a woodcut by the illustrator. The publisher clearly understood that the illustrations are a major source of value for this edition, for the cover proudly advertises with 73 engravings on wood by Agnes Miller Parker. The spine even goes so far as to credit the book to Miller Parker alongside the author H.E. Bates. The signatures are sewn and the volume has plain white end papers. The book follows a simple typographic plan with relatively large type that is comfortable to read. The face is not identified, but it has a telltale capital W that suggests it might be a Garamond variant. Everything is printed letterpress on a paper that is thick, heavy, and opaque. This paper is matte with a smooth surface and feels nice to handle. Miller Parker's woodcuts are simply outstanding. There are a generous 73 in total, ranging from full-page set pieces to smaller inline figures. Many of the illustrations depict the flora and fauna of the English woodland, often with a quasi-scientific accuracy that recalls classic botanical illustration. Since the subjects of the illustrations are identified in the list of figures at the front of the book, these figures are also a welcome visual aid for those who don't know a blackthorn from a hawthorn. Other illustrations show wider woodland scenes where Parker's rounded forms bring a soft, pastoral quality that suits the subject matter exceedingly well. Turning to the text, Bates's passion for his subject matter is obvious. He has a special ability to vividly conjure the sights, sounds, and smells of the world he describes. The first chapter, in particular, does a spectacular job of transporting the reader to experience the not unpleasant surroundings of an English wood in the middle of spring. Other chapters strike a more autobiographical note and recall childhood fascination with woodland trees and the countryside around them. I suspect that readers with a good working knowledge of native English species will derive the most pleasure from this book, which regularly invokes the names of nightingale, finch, beech, birch, and ash. Those who live in ignorance of such affairs, alas, including myself, can nevertheless enjoy Bates's window into this woodland world.